All right, welcome back to Central Valley Buzz, everybody. I'm your host, Chuck Leonard. Willie, let's bring in our next guest, Mr. Michael Bogart. Hello, sir.
Hi, Chuck.
How are you? Nice to see you.
Hey, I'm sorry
about bailing out on you last week.
I
thought about halfway through the show as I was not here. I thought, oh my gosh, what have I done? I've put the Christian guy on with Crazy Bernie.
Crazy Bernie and I got along just fine.
How did it go?
No, he was great.
Yeah.
I have no complaints at all.
What's his stance?
Crazy Bernie? I don't know. He didn't say much, actually. I did most of the talking.
You must have prayed hard before that when he didn't say much.
Not really. The pink suit said it all.
Yeah. You know, did he tell you the story on those suits? He goes to Hong Kong to get these suits made. Probably the ugliest suits I've ever seen.
Yeah.
But from a real, real famous guy that's made suits for every president since, like, Roosevelt.
Really? Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I've seen him every time he's been on this show in the pink suit, so he must like it.
Mm-hmm. He looks good in it. Okay, Michael, you want to talk about the 45-minute Bible today?
Well, yeah, and I wanted to start off by just giving a little bit of a background. I teach in a number of higher education institutions. I teach comparative religion, and I've just started another one for Excelsior College. And I was reading some of my students' introductory, you know, I give them an assignment where they just introduce themselves and talk about whatever spiritual background that they've got. And I would guess that about a third of the students that I read responses on talked about how they'd been raised Christian, but either rejected it when they got older or just kind of dropped out of active participation. And part of it was the idea that the Christian groups that they had been part of valued principles over people. And I wanted to talk a little bit about that. Because I think that's very common. I think all of us have seen that. At least I certainly have. That there's this perception out there that people are devalued compared to principles.
Yeah. Why don't you expand on that? I'd love to hear it.
Well, for one thing. Well, one of my students told a story that just kind of broke my heart. You know, as a pastor myself of many years when I was in Lemoore, I could kind of relate to this. She had she'd been raised in the church. She'd senior year of high school, had gotten pregnant. She'd been living with a friend's family because her own family situation wasn't that good. And this family had been Christian. And so basically told her she had 2 weeks to get out.
So her family was Christian. She was raised Christian. She got pregnant and they threw her out.
The friend's family.
Give her a 2 week notice.
The friend's family said she had 2 weeks to get out. Now, I understand Christians don't want to.
So her family, she
wasn't with her family. Her family was
Christian bad. The Christian family that took her in, right. She got pregnant. They told her 2 weeks, get out.
Right, right. And you know, I understand you don't want to seem to be condoning that sort of behavior and all of that.
Once it's done, it's done.
But we're talking about a child is coming into the world. A young girl's in trouble. And I think to myself,
as a Christian, that's the time to put your arms around her.
That's the time to embrace this girl and say, what can we do to help? At least that's my take on it. Now, there may have been other issues going on that I don't know about. But I hear this over and over again as a pastor myself, that Christian people have reacted in a mean way when people were in trouble. And I think the burden is on us Christians to do something about that. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, I've been thinking about how we've been talking about the religious demographics in this country. We slipped 7 percentage points in terms of population share. Of all Christian groups, we slipped 7 percentage points since 2007. That's part of the reason. Part of the reason is this perception.
I want to get back to this girl here. this poor girl.
Yeah.
She's in time of need more than any time in her whole life.
Right.
These people provided a house for her because they cared for her.
Right.
Kicked her out when she needed her the most. Not very Christian of them.
Well, that would
be. Is that what you're getting at?
Well, that would be the perception. And again, I don't know the situation. Maybe there was more to it than that. But I hear things like this that Christians respond in ways that don't seem loving. And I think that
because they're doing what they think God wants them to do?
They're honoring principle above people. That's my contention, is that's the perception out there. And we Christians are people of principle. I mean, obviously there's a lot of principle involved and we don't want to sacrifice that. But I think the burden is on us to value people and to follow through with what really a big part of our message is, that God loves people and so should we. And what does that love look like? So it gets complicated in various kinds of situations, but I really think for the 21st century, we've got to do a better job of loving people.
How long ago was it when people were wearing all those "what would Jesus do" stuff?
Oh yeah,
was that maybe more than 7 years ago?
Oh yeah, I think so. I think that was back when.
Because I haven't 10, seen 15. One in a while.
That, you mean those little bracelets?
The decline, yes.
The bracelets, "what would Jesus do" bracelets? Yeah, that's been about 10, 15 years ago.
Right.
Easy.
So they've fallen off since then.
You know, we go through these fads and trends just like everybody else, but
that's how you came into it. In the 70s, right?
I was a Jesus freak, absolutely, yeah.
The hippie kind?
Well, not quite the hippie kind, but I was riding on that wave, yeah.
The Jesus Christ Superstar?
Absolutely.
Yeah?
Oh, yeah.
Was that, did that get you going, that Jesus Christ that, Superstar?
No, but that whole time frame was a time, it really changed my life.
It was time of love.
It was a time in which Jesus was real and people were trying to act like what they thought Jesus wanted them to do. Mm-hmm. That impressed me, big time.
What happened to people?
You know,
did the internet ruin them?
I don't know if you can blame it all on the internet. I just think that that there's always these waves of religious excitement and they tend to wear off.
Do they have waves of religious non-excitement too? Is that happening right now?
I think we're in one, yeah. I mean, you see the rise of atheism at the same rate that you see the decline of Christianity.
Because kids don't believe it.
Because it's too far-fetched. There's a lot of factors out there, and part of it is that you know, we're getting into an age in which you can say anything you want on the internet, and you know, a lot of the opponents of Christianity don't mind, you know, breaking the rules. That sort of thing.
How about this? How about them looking at the Bible and some of the stories and saying, you know what? That couldn't have happened like that, instead of looking for what the message is.
That could very well be. And you know, I'm glad you brought that up because it brings in
Teed
my
it
book.
Up for you, Mike.
The 45-minute Bible. You know, and I deal with that very issue. You know, that can supernatural things like miracles happen? You know, the contention of Christianity and of other religions is that if God is who we think he is, he can break the natural laws if he wants to from time to time and do supernatural events. So, I mean, you know, that's an act of faith to believe it, just as it's an act of faith to believe that perhaps he couldn't do that. But yeah, this book, I think, is one of the most revolutionary things that I've ever done in terms of trying to make the Bible and its message accessible to this generation.
Right.
And you know, I've got a passion for it. I really think that this Bible is gonna, that the Bible communicates if it's presented in a way that people can understand.
Well, here's the thing. These days, everybody wants it now, right? No one's got a whole year to sit down and read the Bible.
Right.
45 minutes, maybe we could break that up over a couple months. Huh?
Well, I think so. Right. This is the era of the sound bite, so I guess if you will, this is the biblical sound bite right here.
Okay, and how many other books do you have?
I have 4 other books. As a world religion teacher, I do teach different things, and so I wrote books on the religions that always come up in questions, like, you know, absolutely, you know, Islam is on everybody's minds. But then I always get questions about the Mormons and the Jehovah's Witnesses and the New Age movement. Those are the ones that come up all the time. So I wrote books about those as well as making the videos that go along with them.
Awesome.
As I said, you know, the title of the book is 45 Minute Bible. The video actually is 45 minutes. The book takes a little longer to read.
Depends. You could be a speed reader.
I guess so.
Hey, this is Michael Bogart. MindCuisine.com is where you can find his books. He's here with me every Wednesday. If you have a question for him, just send it to Chuck Leonard, Central Valley Buzz on Facebook, and we'll get it to him. We're going to take a quick commercial break. We'll be right back. Stick around.